Hello students, in this session we will learn about pelvic girdle and the bones of lower limbs. So pelvic girdle is the girdle which gives attachment for the lower limb bones. If you look at this picture, you can see that the pelvic girdle is made up of two bones, one on the right side, one on the left side. It is called as os innominatum, and the two bones are connected at the back. There is the sacrum, that is the part of the last part of the vertebral column, sacrum and coccyx. The sacrum and coccyx is wedged between the two pelvic bones. In the front, the two bones are united to form the symphysis. So the pelvic girdle is a ring of bones. It is attached to the vertebral column at the back, and in the front, the pubis of the two sides of the pelvic girdle will connect to form the pubic symphysis. And the girdle is the one which gives the attachment for the lower limb bones, so that the lower limb bones connects to the axial skeleton. Pelvic girdle consists of the right and the left hip bones. The hip bones, if you see the each hip bone, it's a large, flat, irregularly shaped bone which is formed by the fusion of three bones called as ilium, ischium and pubis. Ilium is the upper part of the bone, ischium is present at the back, and pubis is present in the front. So you can see here the three bones. The one in the pink is the ilium, which is the upper bone. The one light green is the ischium, which goes at the back, and that is the one which supports when you sit down on a chair or any surface. It is the ischium which will support you. And in the front, it is the pubis of the right and left will unite together to form the pubic symphysis. The hip bone, which is also called as coxal bone, as I told you, attached to the sacrum, and in the front, the two will join together. The bony pelvis is the structure which is formed by the two hip bones, the sacrum and the coccyx. All of them together will form the bony pelvis. If you look at the upper bone ilium, that is the largest part of the pelvic bone, and it is firmly united to the sacrum. It joins to the sacrum in such a way that it cannot move. It forms a joint called as immobile joint, and the articulation phase is called as sacroiliac joint, where the ilium is joining with the sacrum to form the sacroiliac joint, and this is an immobile joint which gives the firm attachment of the pelvic girdle to the axial skeleton. Ischium is present on the posterior inferior region, means on the posterior side, that is on the back side and on the lower side, and it supports the body weight when a person sits down. Pubis is the anterior bone. It will curve and it will come in the center. In the center, the pubis of the two bones, that is the right and the left hip bone, will join to form what is called as pubic symphysis. Now we will look at each one of them. The first one is the ilium, that is the biggest bone. You can see some parts in this bone. The first one is called as the iliac crest. It is present on the upper side of the ilium. It is curved and it is called as iliac crest. The iliac crest will form four spines, two on the anterior side, two on the posterior side. The one on the anterior side, which is rounded, present on the anterior side, upper side of the anterior region of the iliac crest, is called as anterior superior iliac spine. And below that, there is another one in the anterior side below the superior iliac spine, which you call it as anterior inferior iliac spine. This is also a rounded protuberance. It is present below the anterior superior iliac spine, and both of the spines will give the area for the attachment of the thigh muscles. Similarly, on the posterior side of the iliac bone, you have the posterior superior iliac spine. So here the crest is curved down and that becomes the posterior superior iliac spine. Then you have the posterior inferior iliac spine, which is present below the superior iliac spine. So there are two spines in the anterior region, anterior superior and anterior inferior, and two spines in the posterior region, posterior superior and posterior inferior iliac spine. Now, in addition to this, there is a rough area called as auricular surface of ilium. This auricular surface of the ilium is the place where the ilium will articulate with the sacrum to form the sacroiliac joint. So, the place where the sacrum is articulating with ilium to form the sacroiliac joint, that surface of the ilium is called as auricular surface, which is a rough area which forms the sacroiliac joint. So all these iliac spines are the regions where the muscles and ligaments are attached, and also it supports the sacroiliac joint. Apart from this, there is a depression called as iliac fossa present on the anterior side in the middle of the upper ilium. On the anterior side in the middle, there is a fossa called as iliac fossa. The inferior margin of this space, if you look at this depression, on the lower side, there is a line which is called as arcuate line of ilium. It is a ridge-like protuberance, and this is very well formed, and there is a change in the curvature between the upper and lower portions of the ilium because of this iliac fossa. Because of the arcuate line of ilium present near the iliac fossa. So you can look at this arcuate line of ilium when we look at the bone diagram. There you can see where the arcuate line of ilium is located at the lower end of the iliac fossa, which is separating the upper and lower portions of the ilium. Then you have a big inverted U-shaped opening present on the posterior margin of the ilium, which is called as the greater sciatic notch. This greater sciatic notch is the notch where the nerves will leave from the spine and goes to the legs. It is called as greater sciatic notch. So that is about the ilium. Now coming to ischium. Ischium is a thick bone. It is a strong bone present on the posterior side and lateral side of the hip region. It has got a large rough area called as ischial tuberosity on the lower side, which is a place for the attachment of thigh muscles, and it will carry the body weight when you are sitting. When the person sits, the weight of the body will rest on the ischial tuberosity. So in ischium, you have to see the ischial tuberosity. Then there is ischial ramus, which is present on the superior anterior side of the ischial tuberosity. So above the ischial tuberosity, on the anterior side is the ischial ramus. Then there is lesser sciatic notch, which is a curve which is slightly smaller, present on the posterior margin of the ischium and above the ischial tuberosity. There is also ischial spine, which is a bony projection which is separating the lesser sciatic notch and greater sciatic notch. So the greater and lesser sciatic notch is separated by the ischial spine. So this is the diagram. I want you people to identify all the points which we have explained so far. What you can see, the brownish colored structure is the ilium. It is the biggest bone in the hip bone. On the top, it has got a curved part, that is the iliac crest. The iliac crest will form two spines, one on the anterior side, two on the anterior side, two on the posterior side. The two on the anterior side present above is the anterior superior iliac spine. On the right side, you can see that anterior superior iliac spine. Below that, you can see the anterior inferior iliac spine. On the posterior side, you can see the posterior superior iliac spine, below which is the posterior inferior iliac spine. Apart from that, there are areas for the attachment of muscles, different muscles like gluteal muscle. You can see the iliac crest, and the remaining part of the ilium is called as the body of the ilium. Then if you look at the ischium, we spoke about the ischium. Here the green colored one is the ischium, which is thicker and stronger. And when the three bones meet, ilium, ischium and pubis, it forms a cup-shaped depression called as acetabulum. We will talk about that later. So in the ischium, you can see the ischial spine, and you can see the U-shaped indentation, that is the greater sciatic notch, which is present just below the posterior inferior spine. Posterior inferior iliac spine, below that is the greater sciatic notch. Below that you can see the ischial spine. Ischial spine is separating the greater sciatic notch and lesser sciatic notch, as we told in the previous slide. Then you have the body of the ischium. Then you can see the ischial tuberosity and the ramus of the ischium. So what all is there in the ischium? First, there is a spine, ischial spine, which is separating the greater sciatic notch and lesser sciatic notch. Then you have the body of the ischium, ischial tuberosity and ramus of the ischium, which comes forward and joins the pubis. So this is what we were talking about in the previous slide. Then the iliac fossa, that is the depression, and also the line. There is another diagram where you can look at the arcuate line of ilium. We will look at that later. So now coming to pubis, it is the anterior part of the hip bone. So the pubis is the enlarged part present in the middle of the hip bone. There is a pubic tubercle which is located superiorly. It is a small bump like structure, pubic tubercle. Then there is superior pubic ramus, which will go on the side, and from the pubic body it will join the ilium. Then there is pectilineal line, which is an arrow ridge running from the superior margin of the superior pubic ramus. So what all you have to see? You have to look at the pubic body, then the pubic tubercle, which is a small bump, then superior pubic ramus, then pectineal line, and the two pubis of the right and left side will join in the center to form the pubic symphysis. Then you can see the inferior pubic ramus, which will extend downwardly laterally from the body. So these are the structures which you have to observe in the pubis. Apart from that, the pubic arch. So when the two bones join together by the pubic symphysis, it forms an arch called as pubic arch, and the bodies and inferior pubic rami of the adjacent pubic bones. The inferior pubic ramus will extend downward to join the ischial ramus. So if you remember the previous slide, from the ischium, the ischial ramus will come and join the pubis. So the pubis will form the inferior pubic ramus. So the ischial ramus will come and join to the inferior pubic ramus. So together they form a single ramus. Now you can call this as ischiopubic ramus, and it will extend from the pubic body to the ischial tuberosity. If you remember, from the ischial tuberosity, the ischial ramus will come. It will come in the front. It will join with the inferior pubic ramus to form the ischiopubic ramus. So the inverted V shape, which is formed by the ischiopubic rami from both the sides, will come together at the pubic symphysis to form an angle called as subpubic angle. So I want you people to just observe so far whatever we have spoken about. So in the ilium, you have the margin iliac crest, anterior superior iliac spine, anterior inferior iliac spine, posterior superior iliac spine, posterior inferior iliac spine. Then the body of the ilium. Then you have the ischium. In the ischium, there is a ischial spine, which is separating the greater sciatic notch and lesser sciatic notch. Then there is the ischial body. Then the ischial tuberosity, from which runs the ischial ramus to join the inferior ramus of the pubis. You can see there, the pink colored ischial ramus is coming forward to join the orange colored pubic ramus to form the ischiopubic ramus, a curvature. Then the body of the pubis, the two will join together to form the pubic symphysis. When the three bones join in the center, you can see there is a cup-shaped depression which is formed. And this cup-shaped depression is the place where the thigh bone will attach. And this part is called as acetabulum, into which the thigh bone will attach. Now, pelvis means what? The entire structure which is formed by the right hip bone, left hip bone, sacrum at the back, below which coccyx, sacrum and coccyx from the vertebral column, right hip bone, left hip bone together will form the pelvis. What is the function of the pelvis? To support the weight of the body when the person is sitting, and when the person stands up, then the weight of the body will be transferred to the lower limbs, and the lower limbs will bear the weight of the body when a person is walking. So pelvis is the place which is providing the area for the attachment of the muscles, the hip muscles, the thigh muscles and the leg muscles, and this will also protect the organs which is present inside the pelvic cavity. So the three bones of the pelvis is ilium, pubis and ischium, which will converge. All the three will come together, they will fuse together, and the point in the center formed by the fusion of the three bones is a cup-shaped cavity called as acetabulum, and into this acetabulum the femur bone will fit. Below that there is another opening called as obturator foramen. This is a large opening present in the anteroinferior hip bone between the ischium and pubis, and this is filled with connective tissue, and this serves for the attachment of muscles both on its external and internal surfaces. So when the two pelvic bones, which is called as innominate bones or os innominatum or right and left hip bone, it is also called as right and left hip bone or coxal bone or innominate or os innominatum, when they join together, it will form obturator foramen between pubis and ischium. It forms acetabulum at the junction of the union of three bones, and this is the place where it is articulating with the femur bone to form the femur hip joint, and all of them are providing surface area for the attachment of the muscle, and also the place where the blood vessels will enter, and also they will provide a pad of fat to support all the joints and functioning of the joints. Now if you look at the pelvic cavity, which is formed by the hip bones and the sacrum and the coccyx, inside you can see a cavity which is called as the pelvic cavity. This pelvic cavity is divided into two regions. The greater part, that is the bigger part, is called as false pelvis or greater pelvic cavity, which is broader and is present at the superior side, that is on the upper side. Here the small intestine and large intestine is located. The lower region is called as lesser pelvis or true pelvis or lesser pelvic cavity. This is present on the lower side. It is smaller in size compared to the greater, and it is rounded, and it contains the urinary bladder and other pelvic organs like reproductive organs. In addition to that, there is a pelvic brim or inlet. This is the superior margin of the lesser pelvis. So, just above the lesser pelvis, there is the pelvic brim or the pelvic inlet, which is separating the greater pelvis from the lesser pelvis. And there is pelvic outlet, which is present on the lower side of the pelvic cavity, and it is a big opening called as pelvic outlet. So, in this picture, you can see the hip bone, the right and the left, with sacrum and coccyx present in the center. The pelvic brim is the one which is separating the upper cavity from the lower cavity. Upper cavity is the greater pelvis cavity, lower is the lesser pelvic cavity. Then you can see the sacroiliac joint, the sacrum with sacral promontory. Then you can see the acetabulum on the side. It is a cup-shaped depression formed at the junction of the union of the three bones. And below that, there is an opening called as obturator foramen. And this obturator foramen is the place where pubis and ischium are fusing. Pubis and ischium are fusing over here, and the nerves and other blood vessels will leave from this obturator foramen. The two pubis in the center will unite together to form the pubic symphysis. And you can see the ramus from the ischium and from the pubis, that is the ischial ramus and pubic ramus, will fuse together to form the ischiopubic ramus. Now, there is difference in the shape of the pelvis when you compare male and female pelvis. The male pelvis is very thick and heavy to support the heavier body weight of the male, and the muscles of the male is very strong, so it has to provide greater surface area for the attachment of the muscle, so the male pelvis will be very thick and heavy. The greater sciatic notch is narrow and deep, whereas in case of females, the greater sciatic notch is broad. The major difference between the male pelvis and female pelvis is that in case of females, since they give birth to the child, so the pelvis should be broader. So to make the female pelvis broad, there are number of changes what you see in the different bones. One of that is greater sciatic notches broader in female than in male. That is the first change. The second one is, if you look at the distance between the anterior superior iliac spine and the ischial tuberosity, it is bigger. The distance is much more in case of female. This will increase the size of the pelvic outlet, that is the opening of the pelvic cavity on the lower side, so that it will help in the process of childbirth. And the subpubic angle is larger in female. So the female sacrum also is wider, that is the sacrum, the last part of the vertebral column, it is wider, shorter, less curved, and the sacral promontory will not project into the pelvic cavity as much as it projects in the male, so that the female inlet or brim will be more rounded or oval shaped compared to the male. And also the lesser pelvic cavity of the female is wider, it is more shallow, and in case of male it is narrow and deep. It is here it is wider and shallow and tapering. The lesser pelvis is tapering in case of males. So you can see all those whatever we spoke about here. If you look at the male and the female pelvis, the male pelvis is stronger, heavier, thicker, and narrower and deep, whereas the female pelvis is not as strong as the male, but it is wider and the angles are more here to increase the space, and the pelvic outlet, the subpubic angle, is more in case of female, which will help in the childbirth. The pelvic brim is more rounded or oval, whereas in male it is more deeper. So these are the changes what you see in case of the male and the female pelvis, which are the modifications you see to help for the process of childbirth. So if you look at this picture, all the three bones put together, ilium, iliac crest. In ilium, what all you have to identify? Iliac crest, anterior superior iliac spine, anterior inferior iliac spine, posterior superior and posterior inferior iliac spine, then the body of the ileum, then there is a fossa in the ileum, then there is an arcuate line. I told you there is a line at the lower end of the fossa, arcuate line, which is the projection of the bone for the attachment of the muscles, and auricular surface on one side of the ileum where it will articulate with the sacrum to form the sacroiliac joint. So these are the ones you have to remember: iliac crest and the four iliac spine, iliac body, iliac fossa, the arcuate line, the auricular surface to form the sacroiliac joint. The iliac fossa is the depression which ends with the arcuate line. These many things you have to remember in the ileum. Then below the ileum is the greater sciatic notch. Then in the ischium, there is ischial spine separating the greater sciatic notch and the lesser sciatic notch. Ischium has got a body, ischial body, then the ischial spine. Then you have the obturator foramen formed at the junction of the pubis and the ischium, through which the nerves and blood vessels will leave. Then you have the ischial tuberosity, from which the ischial ramus will come forward. Then it joins with the pubic ramus to form ischiopubic ramus. So all these things you have to remember in the ischium. Then you have the pubis, where you have the body of the pubis. Then you have superior ramus of the pubis. Then there is a pubic tubercle just above the body. Then you have the pubic body. Then articular surface of the pubis on both the sides, where both will come and join together to form the pubic symphysis. Then you have the inferior ramus of the pubis, which will join with the ischial ramus to form ischiopubic ramus. So these are the ones which we have described the structural details in the previous slides of the three bones, ileum, ischium and pubis, which together will fuse, and the point of fusion is acetabulum, into which the thigh bone will fit in, and between the pubis and ischium you have the opening called as obturator foramen, through which blood vessels and nerves will leave. So the right and the left pubis bone will join together, and in between these two, sacrum and coccyx will be wedged, and this together will form the pelvic bone enclosing the pelvic cavity. So with this we completed the pelvic girdle bone. Now we will look at the bones of the lower limbs. There are 30 bones in the lower limbs. So there are three regions in the lower limbs: the thigh region, then the leg region, then the ankle and the foot. So here we will be learning about the thigh bones and the leg bones in your syllabus. You don't have the ankle and foot bones. We have to learn about the thigh and the leg bones. The thigh bone is called as the femur. It is the biggest bone in the body, and it is the femur which will articulate with the acetabulum of the pelvic girdle to form the joint between the femur and the pelvic. So it is called as the femur joint. Then in the leg there are two bones. The larger bone is called as the tibia or the shin bone, and the smaller bone is called as fibula. The thigh and the leg bones will articulate with each other at the knee joint, like how you had elbow joint in the hand, like that the thigh bone and the leg bones will articulate at the knee joint, and it is protected by a small bone called as patella, which is also called as the kneecap, and it will also support the quadricep tendon. Now we will look at each of these bones. The femur bone, also called as the thigh bone, is a single bone. It is the longest bone of the body, strongest bone of the body, and it will constitute about 1/4 of the height of a person. So if the person is 6 feet, 1/4 of that, around 2 feet, will be the length of the thigh bone. So 1/4 of the size of the body will be the size of the femur bone. The femur has got different regions. Right at the top there is the head. The head is rounded. It is the proximal end of the femur, which will articulate with acetabulum of the hip bone to form the hip joint. On the lower side, it will articulate with tibia to form the knee joint. Then there is patella, which will articulate with the distal end of the femur. So you have the head region and the lower region. Head region will articulate with acetabulum to form hip joint. Lower end will articulate with the tibia to form the knee joint, and there is patella at the knee joint. The next part of the femur bone is called as the neck region. It is a narrow region below the head, and this is called as the area of fracture, especially with aging. When a person falls, it is this region which is prone for fracture, the neck of the femur. And there are two other regions called as greater trochanter and lesser trochanter. These are bony projections. The bigger one is called as greater trochanter, which is present on the upward region. This is a place for the attachment of the muscle. Below that, there is a smaller bony protrusion called as lesser trochanter. This is present on the medial side of the femur, just below the neck. So here you can look at the picture of the femur bone. It is an elongated long bone. On the anterior side, proximal side, you have a rounded head. Then you can see the neck very clearly. The neck separating the head from the shaft. Then you have greater trochanter, that is the big bony prominence. Then there is lesser trochanter. Then there is intertrochanteric crest. In between the greater and lesser trochanter, there is intertrochanteric crest. Then there is a tuberosity called as gluteal tuberosity, to which the gluteal muscle will be attached. Then you have the longer part of the bone called as the body or the shaft, on which there is linea aspera, the area to which the muscles will be attached. If you look at the distal end of the femur, there you have got prominences which are called as epicondyles. There is one medial epicondyle present towards the center, one lateral epicondyle present towards the side. Below the medial epicondyle you have medial condyle, and below the lateral epicondyle you have lateral condyle, and intercondylar notch. There are four prominences here. If you look at humerus, there were only two. Here there are four prominences to support the body weight when the person is standing, that is lateral and medial epicondyle, below which you have lateral and medial condyle, and in between the two there is intercondylar notch, and there is adductor tubercle, to which the adductor muscles will be attached. There is medial and lateral supracondylar lines above the condyles. So these are the structural details what you will have to learn in the femur bone. So you have the head, then you have the neck, you have the greater and lesser tuberosity, and in between the two tuberosity you have got, sorry, it is trochanter. You have the head, then you have the neck. Tuberosity is present in the humerus bone. In case of femur, you call it as trochanter, greater trochanter and lesser trochanter. And in between the two, you have the intertrochanteric crest with gluteal tuberosity. The elongated part is called as the shaft, and it is curved. Gluteal tuberosity is a rough area. It is extending below the greater trochanter. And below the gluteal tuberosity, there is the linea aspera. This is a rough line, and it passes down along the posterior side of the midfemur, and to this the muscles will be attached. On the lower end, there are two condyles, lateral epicondyle and medial epicondyle, and there is lateral condyle and medial condyle. So the condyles are roughened area. One is present on the lateral side, one on the medial side, and to that there is an extension called as epicondyle, lateral and medial epicondyle. The lateral and medial condyles are the ones which will articulate with the leg bone tibia to form the knee joint. So when you see the knee joint, the bones which are involved in the formation of the knee joint is the thigh bone femur and the leg bone tibia. In that, in the femur, it is the condyles which enter into the formation of the knee joint. Lateral condyle and medial condyle enter into the formation of the knee joint. Epicondyles are the place where the muscles will be attached, and also it will support the ligaments of the knee. There is also a small tubercle called as adductor tubercle, which is located on the superior margin of the medial epicondyle. So in between the condyles is the intercondylar fossa, which is a depression which is present on the posterior side, separating the medial condyle and lateral condyle. There is a patellar surface, which is a wide groove, and on the anterior side it is having smooth surfaces of the condyles, and they will join together with the patella bone or the kneecap. So the combination of the medial and lateral condyle with the patellar surface will give the distal end of the femur a horseshoe shape or U shape. A U shaped structure is formed on the lower end of the bone femur. Because of the combination of the medial condyle, lateral condyle with the patellar surface, it gets a horseshoe shape or U shape. Now we will look at the structural details here. If you look at this picture, you can see how the femur is attached to the acetabulum of the hip bone on the top left side diagram. Then down, if you come, you will see that the hip bone has got acetabulum into which the head of the femur will fit. Then you have greater and lesser trochanter. In between is intertrochanteric crest and intertrochanteric line. Then you have the body or the shaft. There is gluteal tuberosity to which the gluteal muscle will be attached. There is linea aspera. It's a line where the muscles will be attached. Then you have the body or the shaft. On the lower end, there are two epicondyles, lateral epicondyle and medial epicondyle. Then you have lateral condyle and medial condyle. So the condyles are the ones which enter into the knee joint formation, and epicondyles are the ones to which the muscles and ligaments will be attached. Then you have adductor tubercle. Then you have the intercondylar fossa. You can see the formation of the U-shaped structure, which is because of the joining of the medial and lateral condyles with the patellar surface, which forms a U-shaped structure, and it will form a joint with the tibia. You should note that in the formation of the knee joint, there are two leg bones, tibia and fibula. Fibula will not play a role in the formation of the knee joint. It is only the tibia which is entering the formation of the knee joint. This you have to remember. Fibula is only a supporting bone. So here another picture just showing the different parts in a much more detail. Both you have on the left side femur, on the right side you have tibia and fibula. So tibia is the bone which is the one which actually enters into the formation of the knee joint. Now coming to the patella. Patella is also called as the kneecap. It is the biggest sesamoid bone in the body. It is irregular in shape. It has got anterior and posterior surfaces. Apex of the patella is present on the lower side, and it is connected to the tibial tuberosity by patellar ligament. It is connected to the tibial tuberosity by the patellar ligament. The base forms the superior aspect of bone, and it will provide the attachment area for quadricep tendon. So there is a tendon here. These tendons are attaching in the knee joint, the quadricep tendon. So the superior side of the patella bone will provide the attachment area for the quadricep tendon, and on the posterior side of the patella it will articulate with the femur, and there are two facets: medial facet to articulate with medial condyle, lateral facet to articulate with lateral condyle. So look at the picture. The patella bone is a sesamoid bone. It is an irregular bone having anterior surface and posterior surface, and it provides the surface for the attachment of the tendons. It has got an apex present on the lower side. On the posterior side, there are two facets, medial facet to articulate with medial condyle, lateral facet to articulate with lateral condyle. What is a sesamoid bone? A sesamoid bone is the one which is present inside the tendon of a muscle. So a muscle is attached to a bone with the help of a tendon, and it is incorporated inside a tendon. Then you call that one as a sesamoid bone. So the tendon crosses over the joint. It will articulate with the underlying bones. So to prevent the damage to the muscle tendon, which is caused because of the friction of the bones rubbing against each other when you move. When you move, there is a friction, and this will result in rubbing of the bones and damage of the bones. So to avoid that, the sesamoid bone is placed inside the tendon, and this sesamoid bone patella will articulate with the patellar surface of the femur, and thus it will prevent the rubbing of the muscle tendon against the distal femur. The patella will also lift the tendon away from the knee joint, and this will give more leverage power, that is more flexibility for the muscles like quadriceps femoris, and this is the one which is going across the knee. And the patella will not articulate with tibia. You should remember this. The patella is only making connection with the femur, and it's not connected to the tibia. And this will provide more flexibility to the joint to avoid the friction caused during movement. Now coming to the leg bone, you have the tibia. That is the bone which enters into the formation of the knee joint, which is also called as the shin bone. This is present in the center. So when you place your leg, the one towards the center is the tibia. The one away on the side is the fibula. So tibia is located on the medial side. It is a large bone. It is the weight-bearing bone. It is the second longest bone in the body. On the proximal side, it has got two expanded regions called as medial and lateral condyle. On the top, these two condyles have got smooth surface and flattened surface, which will articulate with medial and lateral condyles of the femur to form the knee joint. In between, there is intercondylar eminence, which is irregular and it is elevated. It is the point to which the ligaments of the knee are attached. So, the tibia is the strongest bone, the biggest one, the second longest one. It has got on the upper side two condyles, median and lateral, which will articulate with medial and lateral condyles of the femur to form the knee joint. It also has got intercondylar eminence. Then there is tibial tuberosity. Tuberosity is nothing but a small elevated area present on the proximal side of the tibia to which the muscles of the tendon will be attached. And also the tendons are at patella tendons are attached to this region, and more inferiorly the shaft of the tibia will become triangular in shape. As you come down, it becomes triangular in shape. Then when it comes to the end, the tibia bone, it will expand a little on the middle side, that is on the inner side of the body. This expansion is called as medial malleolus or little hammer, which you can see when you feel the ankle region, there is one protruding bone over there on the near the ankle. That is the medial malleolus. It is the expansion present on the distal side of the tibia. It is a bony bump present on the medial side near the ankle. The smooth surface on the inside of the medial malleolus and the smooth area at the distal end of the tibia will articulate with the talus bone of the foot to form the ankle joint. The lateral side of the distal tibia has a wide groove called fibular notch. This area will articulate with the distal end of the fibula, forming the tibiofibular joint. So lateral side of the distal tibia, that is tibia is the leg bone. On the lateral side, on the lower side, there is a groove called as fibular notch, and this is the region where the tibia and fibula will join together and to form the tibiofibular joint. The other bone of the leg is called as the fibula, which is a slender bone present on the lateral side. It is not a weight bearing bone, it is just supporting, and it is the surface to which the muscles will be attached, and the entire bone is surrounded by muscles. Fibula has got head region, which is a small knob like region on the proximal side, which will articulate with the inferior aspect of the lateral tibial condyle, forming the proximal tibiofibular joint. Now, if you look at the tibia and fibula, the two are joined together at two points, one on the anterior side, one on the posterior side. On the anterior side, the head of the fibula will join with the lateral tibial condyle to form proximal tibiofibular joint. Then, if you look at the lower part of the fibula, there it forms a malleolus on the lateral side. It is called as lateral malleolus, which you can also see on the lateral side near the ankle region. The one on the inner side is called as medial malleolus. The one on the lateral side is called as lateral malleolus. Medial side of the lateral malleolus will articulate with the talus bone of the foot ankle. So in the ankle region, there is a bone called as talus. So to this talus bone, the medial side of the lateral malleolus will articulate. The distal fibula also articulates with the fibular notch of the tibia to form the lower tibiofibular joint. Now you can look at this picture. You will see there are two bones, tibia and fibula. Tibia is the fatter bone, fibula is the thinner bone. The tibia has got medial condyle, lateral condyle, which will articulate with medial and lateral condyle of the femur. Then you have the shaft of the tibia. At the lower end, you have medial malleolus. Then you have the tibia. The head of the tibia will articulate with the lateral condyle of the head of the fibula will articulate with the lateral condyle of the tibia to form the proximal tibiofibular joint. The lateral malleolus, there is a articular surface between the tibia and fibula to form the distal tibiofibular joint. Then if you look at the surface is smooth. Then on the condyles, the surface is smooth. Then the two bones are connected by interosseous membrane, for which there is a border. So from the border, the interior osseous membrane will arise, and in between they are connected by the interosseous membrane. So with this, we completed the bones of the leg, that is the tibia and the fibula, and the bones of the thigh, that is the femur. With this, we have completed the syllabus. In your syllabus, you don't have to study the ankle bone and the foot bone, but we will just have a look. In the ankle region, there are 7 tarsal bones, that is the calcaneus, talus, cuboid, navicular, and 3 cuneiforms. The foot bones, there are tarsal bones of the ankle. The toe bones are called as phalanges. The foot, the arch of the foot is formed by the metatarsals. There are 5 metatarsals, 5 proximal phalanges, 5 distal phalanges, 4 middle phalanges, because in the big toe there are only 2 phalanges. So this is how the foot is formed, by the fusion of the different bones like the tarsals, metatarsals, phalanges, and all of them to form the foot region. So with this, we have completed the topic pelvic girdle and the bones of the lower limb. So students, if you have got any doubts, you can get it clarified. Thank you.